New Testament scripture for today comes from 2 Corinthians chapter 8, beginning the first 7. Listen. Now, as you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in utmost ignorance, and in our love for you, so we want you to excel also in this generous spirit. I do not say this as a command, but I am testing the genuineness of your life and thus the earnestness of us. For you know the generous act of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, so that by his poverty you might be rich. And in this manner I am giving my advice, it is appropriate for you who began last year not only to do something, but even to desire to do something. I finish doing it, so that your eagerness may be matched by completing it according to your needs. For if the eagerness is failed, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what one desires. I do not mean that there should be relief for others and pressure on you, but it is a question of a fair balance between your present abundance and their need, since their abundance may be to your need in order that there may be a fair balance, as it is written. The one who had much did not have too much, and the one who had little did not have too much. The word of the Lord. Thank you. I invite you to each other. I am a child of God. I believe in Jesus Christ, my Lord and Savior, and I believe he has the power to change my life. Thank you. When I was in the church for we do a lot of and we complained about all of the stupid things that we had to do that we didn't understand. And how serious and small we was the military tactics. And that's the more interesting, but when you put two words together that are opposite of the case of each other, there's some other examples, clearly confused. Done those with an open secret. And phrases that last more if you function in the same way. Built a barrel of unsteal. I give my right one to be under the gaskets. And body partners pay the decision. You'd be surprised how much it costs to lift this cheap. I'm asking for today, the Apostle Paul says something that might strike us that there might be more. He's talking about the generosity of the church in Macedonia. And he says, quote, knowing that the dear worthy of affliction, their abundant joy and their extreme poverty have overflowed to a wealth of generosity from their planet. Paul says, extreme poverty is severe affliction. Equals overflowing joy and rich generosity. Wow, that's something like that. I'm going to put two terms for that. Did the Macedonians know something to be forgotten? We Americans tend to think that generosity goes with wealth. We tell ourselves we give more if we have more. We'd be more generous if we had more resources. And yet there are many true stories of people in poverty who feel jealous. Reading about back in 1847, severe famine struck the nation of Africa. And the Choctaw tribe here in the United States raised money to send for relief of $147, which in today's terms would be about $5,000. The Choctaw tribe was very poor. That is all you need, and they respond to it. What's even more heartwarming to me about this story is that last year, in the midst of our rate of COVID-19 deaths among the Iowa Christians, the Choctaw tribe set up the GoFundMe page. They wanted to raise money for food, water, and medical supplies for Native Americans. Donations to that particular company flooded the industry. But one Irish sailor wrote out of his fund and said, "Returning your kindness 170 years before that season." So the generosity does not depend on resources. What does it depend on? The Apostle Paul wants us to know that generosity is some natural consequence of Christian devotion. And here he challenges the church of Corinth, which is doing so well in other ways, as well as spiritually and missionary as well. He says, if you want to test your life with God, you say, maybe you'll give it back. Generous giving is critical to the devotional life of a Christian. God, he doesn't call for a fight to embarrass the Christians. He's not laying the dirt to them. He's inviting them to experience the joy of generous giving. Paul doesn't lay out the reasons why generous giving is critical to spiritual health. He just says that it is. But I invite you to see him to explore this a little more deeply than that. Why generous giving is critical to Christian devotion. The first reason is because of the seductive nature of wealth. One would think that those with more wealth would be more generous. But Paul is confirming what we've always expected, that moderate to low-income families, especially church families, are much more generous than typical income families. As a rule, as a percentage of giving income. Of course, there are exceptions. But wealth is seductive. The more we have, the more we want. This is not only about money stuff. Money is a gift, and you're not getting that from it. But money can become a bad thing when it begins to own us. I was reading a study that somebody did about people who had a big jump to the income. Part of the study said that most people would say, well, they didn't need to be really wealthy, they just wanted about a third more than what they actually had. Of course, the people that have a third more than what we have also said they want a third more. Well, in this study, they were studying people who had a sudden drop to return of at least half a year as much as what they were making as a result of the promotion of change in jobs. And when interviewed right after the event, people said that they were happier and more fulfilled with life. But when interviewed a year later, happiness was back to the same levels. And the interesting thing is that many of these people got a bigger house, moved to a better neighborhood, bought a newer car. So that's just twice as much as before. As I said, there are exceptions. Some poor people are very selfish, some wealthy people are very generous. As we didn't find a wealthy man in the world. He's a businessman, and he's very generous with those he needs. And when he was questioned about that, he said, it helps me to slay the devil. It helps me to slay the devil. He went on to say that our greatest temptation is to believe that our happiness or identity can be found in buying newer, better, or more stuff. He pictures materialism as a way in which we must find every day. He says, every time he writes a check without trouble, it's like wheeling a sword to make a bread. There's a reason that Jesus said we cannot serve well to God. Generous giving helps us keep our worship on God rather than things. I think you'll admit that the wagon of materialism is growing. And there is something about wealth that seems to harden us. And one of those people came up with a service of television. They had an act to go up to people who were eating outside in the restaurants and say, "You really want to go to the airport to the arena?" Person after person refused to share. So then, at another act, approached a homeless man in the park. Asking if he was hungry. And I said, yeah. So he gave him a bag with a big bag of fries. And about immediately started closely to what we see in the first Presbyterian, the first act. He said, "You really are a man of God, and you're real." When he knew the things from the sky, he tore his head and gave his head, and he offered to the other. He knew what was right. Not all poor people do that, it's not all that they can do that, stingy. But there's something about owning money that hurts us. Something we must do spiritual rather than debt. So the first thing that Jesus is giving is that because of the seductive nature of wealth, the second reason that Jesus is giving is it's so critical to Christian development because of what money can buy. Money can buy basis for a child. A warm house in a cold house. Most of the good work of the church require money. That doesn't mean that much. But those who are holding the money. What's meaning about that British preacher, Felix Spurgeon? Spurgeon was one of the most famous preachers of the last 1500. And in addition to his ministry, Spurgeon was founder of the American Church of Life. And each year he preached a special sermon to raise money for the Lord. When it's after such a sermon, he was approached by a lady who said truthfully, "Why, Mr. Spurgeon, I thought you preached for souls and not for money." Spurgeon said, "Your money, I do preach for souls and not for money. But my reference point is souls. And if you give my brother, you will repent of these four the size of yours that one of these square meals." All of us probably have a lot of suggestions. Enough money to feed 100 child for several days. We could take care of it. Yes, yes. Generous giving is free of the spirit of talent is that material wealth is self-seductive. But because of the things that money can buy for those who need, it's also critical because the spirit is being helpful. Paul writes in our text for today, "We know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that through his poverty you might become rich." Jesus gave us all the power and glory of heaven to come down to earth, to live among us, to experience hunger, thirst, pain, suffering. We serve a living God. He gave all the forgiveness of our sins to be reiterated in the heart. And if we would follow our Lord upon the way, we'll imitate him in giving generously. And actually, read it, Jesus said, "It's more blessed to give than to receive." Once again, Scripture doesn't give us the reason for that, he just states it to the fact of the Christians. This is what it's like. Just as little insight into Jesus' command. Also, he says, "When you keep what you have, you will be blessed. The more you keep, the more you have, the more you have, the more you will spend on yourself. If you give, you get a blessing. Two people will be blessed by your money. You, which is simple. If you bless as well, give it, bless as well. But it's more blessed to give than to receive." Our point goes on to say that people never discover the suffering and blessing unless they actually do it. And he says, "I've learned that the more they do it, the more they do it." The last thing I want to know is that attitude is important in spiritual growth and development of the people that God wants us to be. Most people do get suffering. So many do it out of a sense of guilt, duty, obligation. We are reluctant givers. Sometimes we think we're cheerful givers. Paul says the Macedonians gave as an expression of their abundant joy. As we heard this prayer, I invite you to reflect on that. Ask God to show how to give as an expression of your joy. And in Jesus Christ, His only Son, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day, He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sat upon the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, the life everlasting. Amen. Our hymn is number 376. Let the Lord all of us. Thank you.
church and my grandchildren and my great grandchildren and my brothers to be heard of Jesus Christ. The church of God became seen in the past and in the future.
Thank you.